Okay, then let's continue with statistics for data science. And today is lecture 10, and the topic is asymptotic estimator properties. And this is the second lecture on estimator properties. Last week we discussed finite sample properties, so when the number of random variables that we are considering, or the number of data points, is constant and equals a specific natural number, such as 10 or 30 or 100 or 1 million. And we discussed what kind of criteria we can then assess for a given estimator to say something about the quality, because again, an estimator in a statistical parametric model is essentially just a function that takes on values in the parameter space of the probabilistic model, or as we've seen for the sample mean and sample variance, in the space of certain summary features of the distribution. And per se, having an estimator doesn't mean that it does anything sensible, because an estimator can be anything, or any function of the data, maybe even the constant function. And so last week we saw finite sample estimator properties, like the expected value of an estimator and the variance of an estimator. And we had a look at the mean squared error, which is kind of a little bit of a combination of unbiasedness, biasness, and variance. And we looked at a lower bound for the variance of an estimator given by the Kramer-Rao bound, which is given by the expected Fisher information. But that was all for fixed sample size. And then today the question is, what kind of criteria are there to assess estimator properties if we allow the sample size to go to infinity? And of course, the intuition here is that more data is better. And that feels fairly natural, because why should more data make inferences worse? At least, maybe if more data is acquired to make an inference about something, maybe the new data is just noisy and doesn't add any information. But even if it doesn't add information, it should not make the performance of any estimators worse. But that's of course a nice intuition, and for some reason humans think this way. But of course, it's just an intuition, and the question is how one can formalize that. And that's the topic for today. There we go. So the material here actually is based a little bit more on the HELD book this week than in previous weeks, because it's kind of these relatively more or less modern concepts that are also a little bit advanced in the statistics setting. So that's where most of the stuff is coming from. Kazel and Berger also discuss asymptotic properties quite nicely. I think the De Groot book, that's in a way where the De Groot book ends a little bit. I mean, they do everything very nicely and very clean and very clear in terms of the foundations. But at one point, of course, the book ends, and for asymptotic statistics, they don't provide that much more. There is a whole book on asymptotic statistics, which is kind of the, in a way, the Bible of this, which is the Van der Waart book, which, however, it's also advanced statistics. So that's a very good book, but it's maybe not for first course at the master level even. That's not the book to go for. But so the HELD book is really the basis for most of the stuff that we do today. So what is asymptotic statistics? Actually, asymptotic statistics is one of the topics in statistics that before I gave the lecture on statistics for data science, I knew that it existed, and then of course I knew that it's interesting to look at if more data is acquired, whether that helps. But it's not something that I actually previously dealt with in my research, so it's kind of, I'm also making my way through asymptotic statistics. And hence this lecture is yeah, kind of a introduction to the field of asymptotic statistics, and as I said, it's it concerns the estimator behavior for large sample sizes. It of course then deals with limits, and maybe the mathematics is a little bit more advanced, maybe not, depends on your mathematical background. What is happening in asymptotic statistics, where we study the qualitative properties of estimators, as I said, and another aspect of asymptotic statistics is to derive estimator distribution or property approximation for large sample sizes. So what can we say? So can we approximate the distribution of an estimator in a large sample size limit? And then even if we maybe cannot say something nicely in the small sample size limit, maybe we can find simple approximations of the estimator or statistic distribution in the large sample limit. And these things then help in the construction of hypothesis tests and confidence intervals, which all are based on statistics or estimator distributions. So there is, on the one hand, it's the qualitative study. The other way is to use asymptotic behavior as a means to construct approximate distributions for estimators in the large sample limit that then are useful in the construction of other statistical techniques like confidence intervals and hypothesis tests. And exactly these approximations that we also discussed today, we will then also see again when we discuss confidence intervals and hypothesis testing in the next 2 weeks. From a kind of modern data science, AI, machine learning perspective, of course, now everybody talks about Corona, but there have been times when people talked about AI, and there have been times when people talked about big data. And of course, in big data, depending on what people actually mean by big data, sample sizes are large. So in this sense, in big data, the results from asymptotic statistics are actually interesting, because you may have many observations of a given feature. Sometimes in big data it's not quite clear whether that means you have a lot of features, so you have high dimensional random vectors, but then you actually only have a few observations, so the relationship between the number of features or the number of dimensions of your random vector and the observations that you have, or the number of random vectors that you're actually considering your random sample, is sometimes not quite clear when people say big data, because they measure a lot of things but only from few experimental units, and then of course this is not a large sample size, it's just a high dimensional random vector. But then, of course, there are really, if you have really many experimental units or random variables from which you measure these things, then you might actually have large sample sizes, and then asymptotic statistics is readily applicable. And from this perspective, even if, I don't know, the math or the theory is a little bit more advanced, and specifically if you read the Van der Waart book, which is listed here, I think next, there is good practical reason to consider asymptotic statistics. It's not something that that is only of academic relevance, but given that sample sizes can be large in modern data sets, and that we are not working in this n equals 30 paradigm that was of interest to the people who developed classical statistics at the beginning of the 20th century anymore, that's actually something, asymptotic statistics actually of relevance for modern data science. And it's also interesting to note that before Fisher and so on developed this small sample size theory, like t-tests, where the t-distribution is essentially the standard normal distribution, but deviates from it if you are at sample sizes smaller than 30. Before that was the case, so in the 19th century, actually these large sample approximations, so normal approximations for confidence intervals, were already used. So it's, yeah, it's in a way a comeback, maybe even of 19th century techniques that we're talking about here. Good. So there are, I think, four essential concepts that we're going to discuss today, maybe five, and they are. To get rid of this here. Can I do something about it? No, it's gone. And they are summarized here on this slide. So we will discuss each of these concepts in more detail as the lecture proceeds. But they're put up here up front so that they don't get lost, and that you, when you study this material, that you first study and memorize these aspects, and then you have a kind of a structure and the basics already in your mind that help you to digest the rest of the lecture. So we assume that we have an estimator, theta hat n, so we use the n here to indicate the sample size. For a parameter of a statistical model based on a random sample of size n, and we are mainly considering actually random variables, so there's nothing special about these x1 to xn. So my brief remarks on random vectors, they are not the most important thing here. Can think of these x1 to xn as univariate random variables. So that's the situation. It's the same situation as last week. But now we are considering what happens if n goes to infinity, and consider a criteria about the quality of estimators in this scenario. And the first one is asymptotic unbiasedness. So an estimator theta hat n is called asymptotically unbiased if, for large sample sizes n going to infinity, the expected value of theta hat n corresponds to the true but unknown parameter value. And it's again about the expected value of the estimator, just as in the bias scenario that we discussed last week. But now the crucial thing is that the expected value only needs to correspond to the true but unknown parameter value in the limit of n going to infinity. Yeah. In a way, you can also view the unbiasedness, as I discussed already last week, of an estimator as a more strict criterion, because there the expected value of the estimator needs to correspond to the true but unknown parameter value for all sample sizes. In the asymptotically unbiased scenario, it only needs to hold for large sample sizes. So that's asymptotic unbiasedness. A different criterion that doesn't use the expected value is the criterion of consistency. An estimator theta hat n is called consistent if, for large sample sizes, the probability that theta hat n deviates from the true but unknown value becomes small. So this is then a probabilistic statement about the distribution of the estimator, and more specifically the probability that the a realized estimator value deviates from the true but unknown value. So it's not about that the average of many samples is corresponds to the true but unknown value, like in the expected value scenario, but that the probability that the actual value of the estimator is different from the true but unknown value becomes small. That's consistency. Then, so these are kind of two different criteria that say, in a way, how close and in which sense an estimator is to the true but unknown value that it's estimating. A third criterion refers to the distribution of the estimators, and this is the notion of asymptotic normally distributed estimators, which say essentially that an estimator is called asymptotically normally distributed if, for large sample sizes, the distribution of theta hat n is given by a normal distribution. Yeah, and then this normal distribution might become smaller and smaller, so that you have consistency, but it's not necessarily the case. So this is a different criterion. It says something about the distribution of the estimator. And finally, there's the notion of efficiency. And this refers to actually three things that happen at the same time, namely that the distribution of the estimator is given by a normal distribution, so we have an asymptotically nominally distributed estimator. The expectation of this corresponds to the true but unknown parameter values, so it's also asymptotically unbiased, and the variance corresponds to the reciprocal of the expected Fisher information, which is the Kramer-Rau bound, so it's as low as possible. Whether it's then also consistent, that's not necessarily the case. But what we will see, and this is also one way to read this lecture, is that maximum likelihood estimators are asymptotically unbiased, consistent, asymptotically normally distributed, and asymptotically efficient. So in a way, maximum likelihood estimators fulfill all of these criteria that we see on this slide, and you can read the lecture also as a justification for the use of maximum likelihood. So if you use maximum likelihood as a way to estimate parameters in a model, then it's guaranteed that your estimators fulfill these asymptotic estimator properties, namely asymptotic unbiasedness, consistency, asymptotically normal distribution, and asymptotic efficiency. And this then also, of course, allows you specifically with respect to the normal distribution to use normal normal distribution approximations for the distributions of estimators in any models that you estimate by means of maximum likelihood, or where you estimate the parameters by means of maximum likelihood, and where the sample size gets large. So that's kind of, in a way, the third way to read this lecture. So one is to read it as about qualitative properties of estimators. The other way is to read it about creating approximations in the large sample size limit for the distribution of estimators. And the final one is, or the third one, let's say, maybe not even more, the third one is to view it as a justification for using maximum likelihood. So that's basically the entire lecture is on this slide. So if you study this, make sure that you're happy with this slide, and then the rest is technical details if you want. And exactly, these are the technical details. So we're going to go over asymptotic unbiasedness, consistency, asymptotic normality, asymptotic efficiency first. So these are the criteria. And then, as in the fifth part of the lecture, we are going to show that the maximum likelihood estimator fulfills these criteria. And it's, of course, a proof. And then, of course, there will be some exercises. So let's start, and with the first thing that we're going to discuss is asymptotic unbiasedness. So how is that defined? Let P denote a parametric statistical model with PDF P theta for theta in the parameter space big theta, and let x1 to xn be a random sample, and let theta hat n be an estimator for theta. So that's essentially the situation or the scenario that we will have all the time, and that we already had last week. So it's the standard parametric statistical inference scenario. Then the parameter estimator theta hat n is called asymptotically unbiased if the limit of the expected values of or the limit of the expected value of theta hat n for n going to infinity equals the true but unknown parameter for all possible true but unknown parameters theta in big theta. And of course, that the expected value of an estimator corresponds to the true but unknown value, that's just the unbiasedness that we discussed last time. And the additional thing here, or the weaker thing maybe even here, is that this equality of the expected value of an estimator corresponding to the true but unknown value now only is required to hold in the large sample limit. And it's also weaker than unbiasedness in the following sense. An unbiased estimator is necessarily asymptotically unbiased because it's already unbiased for small sample sizes. So here's an example for an asymptotically unbiased estimator. It's the maximum likelihood estimator for the variance in a Gaussian model. So let x1 to xn denote a random sample from a univariate Gaussian with expectation parameter mu and variance parameter sigma square. And let sigma square n denote the maximum likelihood estimator. So I didn't put a ml here. One could also put an ml here, but then we had two superscripts and one subscript, so I omitted the ml here. But if for coherence and consistency you would like to see an ml there, let me know, then I put an ml up there. It's obviously defined as the average of the sum of squared deviations of the random variables from the maximum likelihood estimator of the expectation or the sample mean. And we have already seen when we derived the unbiasedness of the sample variance, we have seen the following: the expected value of the maximum likelihood estimator, so of this thing here, is 1 over the expected value of this sum of squared deviations. And what we've shown as a first thing when we discussed the unbiasedness of the sample variance, we've shown that the expected value of this thing here, of the sum of squared deviations, is n minus 1 times the true but unknown variance. And now we have here n minus 1 divided by n sigma square, which is of course not equal to sigma square, because n minus 1 divided by n is not 1. However, n minus 1 divided by n is very close to 1 as soon as n starts to get large, and that's kind of the point here. But first, of course, for small n, the bias can be large. So think of n being 2, then we have 1. 2 minus 1, so that's 1, divided by 2, so we have only half the variance in our estimate, as the expected value of our estimate. However, of course, because this ratio n minus 1 divided by n goes to 1 if n goes large, because then the subtraction of this minus 1 starts to matter less, we have that the limit of the expected values of the maximum likelihood variance parameter estimates goes to the true but unknown variance value, because as you can formally see here, we have the limit of n minus 1 n times sigma square, and this of course the limit of n minus 1 divided by n is 1, so we get sigma square. This means that in the limit of large samples, the maximum likelihood estimator for the variance parameter of a Gaussian distribution is unbiased. And that is also visualized here. This is actually a similar plot to the one that I showed you last week. What I last week wasn't that happy with is what I show here is actually the sample variance and the maximum likelihood estimator. So the green thing is the sample variance. Last week you might remember there were some up and downs here at these low sample size values, which are around, so this is 10, so maybe 15, 20 or something like this. This is log. The point is here I ran more simulations. I think I ran 100,000 simulations to estimate the expected value, and then you see that the sample variance is in fact unbiased, but the maximum likelihood estimator that we just discussed, and here I changed the notation for that, that's a little bit unfortunate, but anyway, is biased for low sample sizes here starting from 10. Of course it goes further down as we go even below 10, and it remains biased well, depending on what you, how much you are, so at least from this graph, of course it always depends on your sensitivity, it remains somewhat biased up to 1,000 samples, but of course the bias is also fairly small, right? So the, at 100, the bias for this variance, which is 1, is only roughly 1 or 2 percent here. The bias is there, but it's small, and it gets smaller for larger sample sizes. So that's asymptotic unbiasedness. And yeah, we will see later code underlying this in the exercise session. So that's asymptotic unbiasedness, relatively straightforward extension from the notion of unbiasedness as we discussed already last week. Next topic then is consistency. Here's the definition. Let P denote a parametric statistical model with PDF P theta for theta and big theta. Let x1 to xn be a random sample with this PDF or PMF, and let theta at n be an estimator for the true but unknown parameter theta. Then a sequence of estimator theta hat 1, theta hat 2 is called a consistent sequence of estimators if for every epsilon larger than 0 and every theta in big theta, the limit of the probability of the absolute value of theta hat n minus theta to be smaller than epsilon equals 1. These are always long sentences, so I forget the beginning of the sentence at one part of the sentence, so that's why I got stuck. This is of course equivalent to the fact that the limit of the probabilities of the absolute values of the estimator deviances from the true but unknown parameter to be larger or equal to epsilon equals 0. Yeah, so the probability that the estimator is close to the true but unknown parameter goes to 1. The probability that the estimator deviates by a given amount epsilon from the true but unknown value goes to 0. And of course this with the epsilon is of course the idea that the epsilon is larger than 0 but arbitrarily small. And if you make it arbitrarily small, then of course this says that the estimator deviates less and less from the probability to for the estimator to deviate less and less from the true but unknown value becomes large. And if you have this consistent sequence of estimators, of course you can from a mathematical perspective view this whole thing under the notion of convergence of functions or function sequences, because estimators in the end they are of course functions, and you can talk about sequences of estimators, but one can also just say that theta at n is a consistent estimator if this sequence is a consistent sequence. So in other words, as n goes to infinity, the probability that theta at n is arbitrarily close to theta becomes high. Or stated differently, as n goes to infinity, the probability that theta at n deviates from theta becomes small. And these properties hold for all possible true but unknown parameter values. So that's for theta, for an arbitrary true but unknown theta in the parameter space. And this kind of setup here, that you have a limit of probabilities, and inside the probabilities you have something that changes as a function of n. We've seen this before. This is just convergence in probability. So we've seen exactly that previously. So it's the same kind of notion of convergence. And now to show that a given estimator is consistent, one can actually address these probabilities directly. And one theoretical exercise does that, so that there the aim is to show the consistency of the sample mean directly. But it can also relatively straightforwardly shown based on the mean square error. So remember that we discussed the mean square error last time, which is this bias variance decomposition, which exhibits this bias variance decomposition, where the mean square error of an estimator is given by the square of the bias plus the variance. And there we have the following criterion for consistency. So we have the same situation. Then if the limit of the mean square error of theta hat n, so here just written out, so the limit of the expected value of the squared deviation of the estimator minus the 2 by unknown value is 0, then theta hat n is a consistent estimator. So, yeah, stated again differently, if the mean square error goes to 0 in the limit of large sample sizes, then theta hat n is consistent. So to check whether an estimator is consistent, you essentially only need to check the mean squared error. Why is this the case? This is a direct consequence of Chebyshev's inequality, which we also studied in this lecture on inequalities and limits, where we found that the probability for the absolute deviation of something to be larger than from something larger than epsilon is smaller or equal to the expected value of the square of this divided by epsilon square. And then of course here on the right hand side we have essentially the mean square error. So if you're not quite happy with this, go back to lecture 7, then you will see that this is just Chebyshev's inequality, which we also proved there. And then if we just write limits on both sides, we have the criteria, and it is the case that actually this limit here is 0, then the limit of these probabilities must be smaller or equal to it, and it cannot be smaller than 0, so it must equal 0. So basically from the fact that the mean squared error goes to 0 in the limit of large sample sizes, it's always then, this always implies that the estimator is consistent. Then this one can take one step further. Of course, the mean squared error can be decomposed into bias invariance terms. And now if the bias and the variance go to 0 in the large sample size limit, then the mean squared error goes to 0 in the large sample size limit, and hence the estimator is consistent. And this is what is then written down here. So if, yeah, what I just said, the limit of the bias is 0 in the large sample size limit, and the limits of the variance estimator is 0, then we have a consistent estimator. And this just follows that from the fact essentially that if the bias goes to 0, then also the squared bias goes to 0, and that's essentially it. Now, how can one use this? Well, one can use this fairly straightforwardly to show the consistency of the sample mean. So consider the sample mean as an estimator of the expected value of the of a Gaussian, or you can also, yeah, think of the sample mean here as the maximum likelihood estimator for the expectation parameter of a Gaussian random sample. Then we have seen previously that the bias of the sample mean is 0, so that's always 0 regardless of the sample size, and we have seen that the variance of the sample mean is given by 1 over n, the 2 but unknown variance. This is also something that we've shown last week. Actually, this week we are capitalizing a lot on previous results, so if something is unclear, always go back a few lectures and you will see that we actually discussed that previously. Sometimes I also forget that we discussed this previously. But the variance of the sample mean is 1 over n sigma square, and of course 1 over n sigma square goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. Hence the bias and the variance of these estimator go to 0, hence the mean squared error goes to 0, hence the sample mean is consistent. Yeah. And then later in the exercise session I will also show you how you can show, or how one can show, that the sample mean is consistent without going in without using this criterion. But so to the aim there is to exemplify a little bit more the actual definition, because here we basically just, we don't use the definition much, we just look at the bias and the variance of the estimator. But that's also some good use of the mean squared error as a finite sample size criterion that we can take also have a look at in the asymptotic scenario and use there. Okay, or I think we have some time to go over these two asymptotic criteria next, and then after the break discuss maximum likelihood estimation. So the next thing, so we now discuss asymptotic unbiasedness. It's just unbiasedness in the large sample size limit, consistency, which is a statement about the probability for the estimator value to deviate from the true but unknown value, and now we are talking about the distribution of estimators in the large sample size limit. And to this end, we first introduce the notion of asymptotic normality. So again, p parametric statistical model, PDF p theta, random sample x1 to xn, and theta hat an estimator for theta. And now what we introduce is this theta tilde, which is a random variable that is normally distributed with expectation parameter mu and sigma and variance parameter sigma square. Then if the sequence of estimators or of random variables theta at n converges to theta tilde in distribution, so remember that we discussed different convergence types in this lecture 7, and one of them was convergence in distribution. There was convergence probability. We've just seen that again, convergence in distribution, and then there was also almost sure convergence. This is not coming up again, luckily. So here we're considering convergence in distribution. Then theta at n is said to be asymptotically normally distributed. So if theta hat n, these random variable sequence converges to the random variable theta tilde in distribution, then theta at n is said to be asymptotically normally distributed, and we write this as theta at n tilde for distributed, but then with the a on top, so that this only holds in the asymptotic limit of n going to infinity, and then the distribution that we're interested here in is the normal distribution, hence asymptotic normality. Remember that convergence distributions means that the limit of the CDFs of these random variables corresponds to the CDF of the random variable that this convergence is against. Yeah, that is asymptotic normality. You can also, intuitively, you can of course also, if you don't like to think about in this CDF statement, you can also just think, okay, we have a distribution of the estimator that of course is created by the distribution of the data, and as the sample size gets large, this distribution looks more and more like the normal distribution. And of course one needs to, this is just a criterion. It's at this point we haven't shown for any estimator that this is actually the case. It's just saying if for some estimator this would be the case, then we would call this asymptotic normal, but we don't know yet whether any estimator actually exists for that, for whom that holds. Finally, asymptotic efficiency. Asymptotic efficiency, again in the same scenario, but now we're also considering the expected Fisher information of the random sample x1 to xn, like we introduced last week. So the expected Fisher information, again, being the expected value of the negative second derivative of the log likelihood function. Then if the estimator is asymptotically normally distributed, so what we just introduced, and now not asymptotically normally distributed with any kind of parameters, but asymptotically normally distributed according to a Gaussian with expectation parameter corresponding to the true but unknown value, which of course also then means that the expected value of theta hat n because theta, so the true but unknown value, is the expected value of this Gaussian, hence also of this estimator, which also means that it's asymptotically unbiased. A normal distribution with expected expectation parameter theta and variance parameter corresponding to the inverse of the expected Fisher information, which you might remember is exactly the Kramer-Rau lower bound, then theta at n is said to be asymptotically efficient. So asymptotic efficiency implies, of course, asymptotic normality, because we are saying the theta hat n here is asymptotically distributed according to a Gaussian. It implies asymptotic unbiasedness, because the expected value in the limit of n going to infinity is the true but unknown value. That's asymptotic unbiasedness. We call, just to have a word for that, we call the variance of this asymptotic distribution the asymptotic variance, and the asymptotic variance attains the Kramer-Rau bound, because it's exactly the inverse Fisher information. So that's asymptotic efficiency as defined here, and as you find it also in I think that's mainly based on the Casella and the Held book. However, while most authors agree on definitions like bias, normal, asymptotic normal distribution, and consistency and so on, efficient estimators sometimes can mean different things in different, if authors write differently about it. So if you open statistics books, you can be confident that the authors define biases the same way, but you cannot necessarily be confident that they define efficiency the same way. This is the definition of efficiency that we use here, but if you read a paper that claims that a certain estimator is asymptotically efficient, have a close read of how they define efficiency. This is one way to define it, and of course it has its use, but of course it's just a word, and it's more important what it entails, namely that the estimator is asymptotically normally distributed, and this asymptotic normal distribution has expectation parameter corresponding to the true but unknown parameter that the estimator is estimating, and has variance corresponding to the inverse or reciprocal Fisher information, hence corresponding to the Kramer-Rau lower bound for the variance of the estimator. So this estimator of course then has the lowest possible variance for all unbiased estimator. So that's quite a strong result. Yeah, so that's basically what I wanted to do in the first hour. In the second hour, we will then look at maximum likelihood estimators and find the following, namely that maximum likelihood estimators are not necessarily unbiased, consistent, asymptotically normally distributed, asymptotically unbiased, and asymptotically efficient. And this is what we actually want to study and also show and prove up to a certain level of granularity. Good, so that's it for the first hour. Again, you should always with this lecture come back to this overview. So we now provided some details for these definitions here, and then the second hour we'll consider the maximum likelihood estimator. Are there any questions right now?
I actually wanted to ask about any of the use cases of asymptotic statistics in machine learning or deep learning. What would be the application of the concepts what we are learning right now?
So basically what I that's what I tried to say here. So first, also the most important application is that I wouldn't say machine learning, I would say in data analysis, because in machine learning you of course people also develop estimators, but then they don't call them estimators and they don't think about things probabilistically most of the time. But of course you learn parameters in machine learning all the time. That means you estimate parameters. And the question is whether the parameters that you estimate or the way that you estimate or your procedure to estimate these parameters is actually sensible, in the meaning that it does something good, so that it actually does something sensible in the criteria that we discussed today. So that's so essentially it's about justifying procedures for learning parameters. So of course, because it's easy, you can always learn something, and then but then you need to decide whether the method that you propose to estimate certain parameters of a model is actually useful. And these are criteria that help you to decide whether something is useful. The other application, and this was also the same thing for last week actually, so the finite sample size estimator properties, that's the same idea. So are the methods, so the basic question is, the methods that I'm developing here as the crazy machine learner, are they any good? Because often you find people proposing this and proposing this and validating it on a little data set. But the question is this something good in general? And this is of course something where you here have the machinery and criteria to test that. The other thing is what I also said is if you want to construct confidence intervals or do hypothesis testing, then it often is not a bad idea to use large sample approximations. And these are justified then by these methods. So these are the applications. And of course you can say, oh, okay, I don't care whether what I'm doing here makes any sense. I just put it into my favorite fancy Python toolbox that has this cool website and has this cool name. But I don't care about whether it's doing anything sensible. Or you say, okay, it's all very cool, but is it sensible? And for example, if you think about variational inference, which is something that I in my own research have been following a bit and also will talk about at the end of the course here, for variational inference, which is kind of a new or novel paradigm that for inference that only started to be developed since the 2000s maybe, the study of the qualitative properties, which actually variation inference in machine learning coolness, people call this variational autoencoders, but that's just variational inference. This paradigm is only around for about 20 years, and by now people are starting to study actually how good this is actually is, because it's kind of. The first step is to develop a new method, but then the next thing is to reflect on this method and ask whether this is actually sensible and doing better than other methods, and what are the criteria for this. And so current research actually is considered with studying the frequentist properties of variational autoencoders, so variational inference. So these are all important applications. Okay, then let's stop here. And thanks for the questions, and continue at 8:30. Okay, then let's continue. So after we introduced these four properties of estimators in the large sample limit, the aim for the second hour today is then to study a specific case in which actually these criteria all hold, and the specific case is the set of maximum likelihood estimators. And of course this is quite a large set, because you can derive maximum likelihood estimators in most probabilistic models. And hence also another way to view what we're doing next is to justify the use of maximum likelihood estimation. So as I already mentioned at the end of the last lecture, or the last hour, maximum likelihood estimators are not necessarily unbiased, consistent, asymptotically normally distributed, asymptotically unbiased, and asymptotically efficient. And this is what we then want to now study in further detail. And we start with showing that maximum likelihood estimators are not necessarily unbiased. And of course, the example here is the maximum likelihood estimator for the variance of a Gaussian, now in a third notation here. I really should maybe think of a consistent notation, but the definition and the actual formula is, of course, crucial, not so much where and how, which superscripts are at a symbol. So let's again assume that we have a random sample of size n that is univariate Gaussian with expectation parameter mu, variance parameter sigma square, and we have the maximum likelihood estimator for the expected value, and we have the maximum likelihood estimator for the variance parameter. And as I mentioned previously today, and as we also have seen last week already, the expected value of these sum of squares or sum of squared deviations of the random variables from the sample mean is n minus 1 times the true but unknown parameter, which is the true but unknown variance parameter, hence not the true but unknown variance parameter. And if we use the maximum likelihood estimator, we divide this by n, as we've already seen also today, and hence have a biased estimator. So this is really no new information here. We've seen last week that this is biased, and we've seen today that it's asymptotically unbiased, and here it's just brought up again as an example for a maximum likelihood estimator that is not unbiased, which then proves by means of example that maximum likelihood estimators are not necessarily unbiased. That was just essentially for completeness. More important are now the following theorems on consistency and on efficiency, and they also involve a little bit of elaborate proofs. So the first theorem that we want to discuss is the following. It's about the consistency of maximum likelihood estimators. So let P be a parametric statistical model with PDF P theta for theta in the parameter space big theta. Let x1 to xn be a random sample, and we assume that the Fisher regularity conditions hold. So these are these conditions that we discussed last time when we discuss the notions of Fisher information and score functions and Kammerau bound, which are fairly weak conditions in all standard random parametric statistical models. So it's not these are not very strong conditions in this setting. Then let further theta hat n ml denote the maximum likelihood estimator. So we are this is maybe now different with respect to what we've seen previously today. So previously we've seen always just theta hat n, and now we are considering specific estimators, namely theta hat n ml, namely maximum likelihood estimators for the true but unknown value theta. And we assume here that theta ml is defined as a local maximizer of the likelihood function based on a sample size n. So we don't necessarily need theta hat mln to be the global maximizer, because we will only consider a local maximum of the likelihood function anyway. But of course, in the case of concave log likelihood function, like in the Gaussian, this of course coincides as there's only one maximum. So we need the fact that theta ml maximizes the likelihood function, and that's of course just the definition of the maximum likelihood estimator. So if these criteria are fulfilled, so essentially we have a maximum likelihood estimator for a statistic parametric model, then there exists a consistent sequence of maximum likelihood estimators, theta 1, theta 2. There are actually this is a typo. There we should have to the power of ML, because this is a this is about maximum likelihood estimators, not of any estimators. So then there exists this consistent sequence, and if there is a consistent sequence of estimators, one also says that this is a consistent estimator. So, for short, maximum likelihood estimators are consistent. Now, in other words, and this is of course just explaining again what consistency means, the maximum likelihood estimator converges in probability to the true but unknown value theta. Formally, we have this limit of the probability of theta at ML deviating in absolute terms from the true but unknown value being smaller than epsilon being 1 for every arbitrarily small epsilon and every parameter value. And one can prove that, and we are going to show that, and these can be more or less general and deep. So we are following the Held approach here, which is based on this local maxima, and we can also make this talking about the maximum likelihood estimator as the global maximizer, and then have it even more general. But yeah, it's more about showing you how one can in principle prove this rather than to have the most awesome proof here, although it would be nicer to have a more awesome proof in the sense that it's a little bit simpler. In any case, the theorem states that for large sample sizes, maximum likelihood estimates equal the true but unknown parameter value with a certainty. So the probability to get as an estimate of a parameter the true but unknown parameter value if you use maximum likelihood in the large sample size limit is 1. So they're doing a sensible thing, maximum likelihood estimators, if the sample size gets large. So how can one show that? So this I'm going to read mainly because it needs some thinking, and it's based on a Held section 4.22, sorry. So the idea here is to show that there exists a maximum of the likelihood function in an interval around the true but unknown parameter value. So the idea is to show that there is a maximum which can be possibly local, so it's not shown that this is the global maximum, but there is a maximum of the likelihood function in an interval that is arbitrarily small around the true but unknown parameter value. And if there exists this maximum, this implies of course that a maximum likelihood estimator, the value of which corresponds to the location of the maximum in parameter space, is then arbitrarily close to the true but unknown parameter value. But we are showing, what we're showing is here is where the maximum of the likelihood function is. And so the idea again is to show that there exists a possibly local maximum of the likelihood function Ln in an interval theta minus epsilon theta plus epsilon, so the open interval around the true but unknown parameter value for arbitrary small epsilon, and this maximum of the likelihood function exists in this interval with probability 1 as n goes to infinity. And as I already mentioned, because the likelihood function is assumed to be continuous and theta hat ml is understood as a local maximizer of the likelihood function, this entails that the absolute deviation of theta mln from the true but unknown value to be smaller than epsilon has probability 1 as n goes to infinity. So because there is this local maximum, then a local maximizer, so the maximum likelihood estimate is also there with probability 1 as n goes to infinity. And this, of course, is the same as saying that the sequence of theta at ml n converges in probability, because this is again just the definition of convergence of probability, that the absolute deviation to be smaller than epsilon is going to 1 as n goes to infinity. And to make things a little bit simpler, we are going to show the following, to show that there is a maximum of the likelihood function in this interval, so theta minus epsilon, theta plus epsilon with probability 1. It's enough to show that the probability for the likelihood function at theta to be larger than the likelihood function at theta minus epsilon equals 1, and that the limit for the likelihood function at the limit of the probability for the likelihood function to be larger than the likelihood function at theta plus 1 is also 1. So essentially we're just showing that the likelihood function is larger at the location of the true but unknown value than at an arbitrarily small deviation to the left or to the right of this point. And to make things simpler, and not because the argumentation to show that this is the case and to show that this is the case, we are only considering one of them, and as homework you can write it out for the other location. So, because analogous arguments can be made to show either of these statements, we consider only the first. So we want to show that the probability for the likelihood function to be larger at the location of the true but unknown value than at the true but unknown value minus epsilon is 1 in the limit of large sample size, large sample sizes. This can be shown using the weak law of large numbers and the KL divergence, as we will see in a second. Yeah, so that's the overall logic. Essentially, we're trying to say that there is a maximum of the likelihood function in an interval around the true but unknown value. The maximum likelihood estimator is of course the point in parameter space where this maximum is attained. Hence in the large sample size limit, the maximum likelihood estimator is arbitrarily close to the true but unknown value. Now, to show this, we have to actually consider this event that the likelihood function at theta is larger than the likelihood function at theta minus epsilon. And to set it this up, these are of course this is an event, but of course ln theta is a random variable because it depends on the data. So the value of the likelihood function at theta is random because the likelihood function is random because it depends on the data. And we first now reformulate this as follows. So we divide on both sides by n and take the logarithm on both sides on n. And then of course the statement that this is larger than this corresponds to the inequality that this minus this is larger than 0. And then we substitute for the log likelihood function here, because we have ln, so the log of ln, we substitute the respective probability. Substituting for the likelihood function here, of course, but this is then of course the log likelihood function, and yeah, so here we have the product, here we then have the sum over the logarithms of the density of the xi, and the same thing here. Of course here this is the density with theta as parameter, and here's the density with theta minus epsilon as parameter, and this is larger than zero. And of course we can then use the log properties to rewrite this as 1 over n, the sum of the log of the ratio of p theta xi divided by p theta minus epsilon xi is larger than 0. Yeah, so we now just rewritten this event, so the event that the log, sorry, that the likelihood function at the two-byte unknown value is larger than the likelihood function at a value deviating from the two-byte unknown value somewhat, is the same as saying that the sum of the logs of the ratios of the individual densities of the data is larger than zero. Why did we write it as this? Because first of all, we can then use the weak law of large numbers. We have here an average, so you see 1 over n times a sum. So recall that the weak law of large numbers states that the sample mean of n independent identical distributed random variables xi converges in probability to the expected value of xi. So if we apply this, so this is just the sample mean approximates the expectation, so if we apply this to the random variable random variables log p theta xi divided by p theta minus epsilon xi, we have that this average here converges in probability to the expected value of the log of this ratio of x, where x of course is, has the same distribution as each of the xi. Now, so here we use the weak law of large numbers, and what we then have here on the right hand side is actually the Kullberg-Leibler divergence. There's a typo, not Leibler but Leibler. The Kullberg-Leibler divergence between p theta x and p theta minus epsilon x. And under the Fisher regularity conditions, these are actually different PDFs. So one of the Fisher regularity conditions was that if you have a different parameter, the densities are actually different. And what we have studied, so the before when we discussed Kullberg-Leibler divergence, that the Kullberg-Leibler divergence is non-negative. Wonder, have we actually shown that? I don't know. We will need it again when we talk about Bayesian inference, so definitely latest at that point we will show it, if we haven't shown it yet. But the Kullberg-Leibler divergence is zero if the two densities that are considered are equal, and it's larger than zero if they are not equal, because it measures the difference or the distance between probability density functions. So these two density functions that we're considering are different due to the Fisher regularity conditions because they have different parameters, hence the Kullberg-Leibler divergence is larger than zero. And what we then have shown is that this expression here converges in probability to a value that is larger than zero. So we have just shown that this average converges in probability to a value larger than zero. And of course this corresponds to a limiting probability of 1 for this expression to be larger than 0. So what we have shown is that the limit of the probabilities of these averages is larger than 0. Sorry, the limit of the probabilities for these things to be larger than 0 is 1. Yeah, because we have shown this convergence in probability to a value larger than zero. This event here is the same event as our event of interest, namely that the likelihood function at the true but unknown parameter value is larger than the likelihood function at a value slightly removed from this true but unknown value. Hence, we've shown the convergence in probability of ln theta to be larger than ln theta minus 1 to 1, so that the limit of this probability is 1. And this was what we wanted, what we need to show here, to show that there exists a maximum of the likelihood function ln in this interval with probability 1 as n goes to infinity. Yeah. So if you go again over this proof, the aim is to show this, and this is then shown by reformulating the event of interest and using the KL divergence, and this can then be established, and hence we have shown this, and hence we have shown the consistency of maximum likelihood estimators. And yeah, so that's one proof that goes to some depth but and some generality, but not full generality. If you think kind of a reference text for all of these proofs in a way is the Van der Waart book. If you want it more general and more formal, that's something where you can get it, but the logic is often the same. So the logic of these proofs is always essentially going by means of the KL divergence, and to have something that is larger than zero, and to use the weak law of large numbers. So maximum likelihood estimators are consistent. This is what we have established now. And then the last thing that we want to do today is to show that maximum likelihood estimators are also efficient. So efficiency again implying asymptotic unbiasedness, asymptotic normality, and variance corresponding to the Kammerauer bound. Good. So last theorem and proof then for today, the asymptotic efficiency of maximum likelihood estimators. We are in the same situation as previously. We're considering maximum likelihood estimators for the true but unknown parameter theta, and we denote by Jn the expected Fisher information of the random sample, and we assume that the Fisher regularity conditions hold. Then the maximum likelihood estimator theta hat nml is asymptotically efficient. That means, just as a recap from the last hour, that theta ml is asymptotically normally distributed, and this asymptotic distribution, this asymptotic normal distribution, has expectation parameter theta and variance parameter corresponding to the reciprocal of the Fisher information. Again, I said that when I opened the slide, but I say it again now, the asymptotic efficiency of the maximum likelihood estimator implies the asymptotic unbiasedness, because the expected value is the true but unknown parameter value, and it implies the asymptotic normal distributeness, because obviously this is a normal distribution. Oops. And like maybe also then relating to the question that we discussed at the end of the last hour, and also giving kind of an outlook to lectures 11 and 10, we are going to use this asymptotic distribution of maximum likelihood estimators to construct approximate confidence intervals and hypothesis test in lectures 11 and 12, and we will see also examples for this today in the exercises. One relating to the Bernoulli distribution, which one of your colleagues will present, and then I think one relating to the variance of the Gaussian, which I will then present. So we're going to look at what this entails or means in a little bit more detail in the exercises. Now we want to actually prove this theorem so that this is the case. And this again follows the HELD book, section 4.23, And the aim that they have there is to show that the square root of the expected Fisher information times the maximum likelihood estimator is asymptotically distributed according to a standard normal distribution, which then just by means of the is there something missing? Sorry, let me just check something. Yeah, there's something missing. Is there something missing? I feel there's something missing here. There should be a minus theta in there. Sorry, because otherwise it doesn't make sense that this is zero. So sorry, this is quite a considerable typo here. This should be hat theta ML n minus the true but unknown value, because then it makes sense that this is zero centered and corresponds to the statement that the maximum likelihood estimate itself is asymptotically normally distributed, not zero centered but centered on theta. So this is here this translation, and it has and there's also something. This is so the thing is this is again the endpoint, so it doesn't feature in the proof much, but sorry for these typos here. So this should be, because this is the this is the square root of the variance, and the variance should be the inverse of the Fisher information. So I will correct that and upload the slides again. Essentially, this should be so the crucial thing here is of course this, and this is correct. So the maximum likelihood estimator is asymptotically normal distributed with a expectation parameter corresponding to the true but unknown parameter, and variance corresponding to the inverse Fisher information, and this is just the Z transformation of that. So the Z transformation meaning that you subtract the expected value and you do now I'm confusing myself too much. Sorry, and you divide, so that's fine. This is always, once I start to be uncertain about something I think I did everything wrong, but that's not the case. So it's the Z transformation. Z transformation meaning you subtract the expected value, so the minus theta must be in here, and you divide by the square root of the variance, and this of course corresponds to because the variance here is 1 over j n theta, this of course corresponds to multiplying with j n theta and taking the square root. So that's fine, that's just the minus theta is missing in this bracket. So the aim is hence to show the Z transformed scenario, namely a square root of j and theta times theta ml minus theta is asymptotically normally distributed according to a standard Gaussian, and with a Z transformation then concluding that the maximum likelihood estimator is distributed according to a Gaussian with theta and 1 over jn. And to prove that, one needs kind of four building blocks, namely the continuous mapping theorem, Slutsky's theorem, the fact that the score function converges in distribution to the normal distribution with variance given by the Fisher information, and the fact that the expected Fisher information, and that the Fisher information converges in probability to the expected Fisher information. So these are the four things that are required, and we will first now introduce these four building blocks and then return to the result and show where it follows from. So first, what is the continuous mapping theorem? that essentially states that convergence and probability and convergent distributions are preserved under the application of continuous univariate real valued functions. So if you have a sequence of random variables xn that converge in probability to a random variable x, then also the functionally transformed random variables xn converge in probability to the functionally transformed random variable x, if f is of course a nice mapping, continuous mapping. And this holds for convergence and probability and for convergence and distribution. And this was shown by Mann and Bald in 1943. And if you have doubts about this, then of course you can go into the literature and find proofs for that. We take these things as given and are not proving them here. Something related is shown in Slutsky's theorem, namely that if xn converge in distribution to a random variable x and yn converge in probability to a constant a, then the sum of xn plus the sum of xn and yn converges in distribution to x plus a, and the product of xn and yn converges in distribution to the product ax. And again, so it's this is your convergence probability, the rest is about convergence and distribution, and it's about combining random variables that have certain convergence criteria. And again, Slutsky's theorem, if you have doubts about it, you can go into the literature and find the proofs for it. We take it as given. The next thing that we need to show the asymptotic efficiency of maximum likelihood estimators is to show that the score function that we introduced last week, divided by the square root of the sample size, converges in distribution to this a normal distribution centered on zero and with variance corresponding to the expected Fisher information. And here this is then of course a use of the central limit theorem, but let's see how this works. So first we note that the score function of a random sample n can be written as the sum of the score functions of individual random variables. I filled in, so this is fairly straightforward because this is always just due to the fact that the random variables are independent, so you have the product of the densities and then you form the log for the score function, so for the log likelihood function, and hence you turn this into a sum. And so this additivity properties of Fisher information, and now I realize I also should the additivity property for the score function. I put that in the other lecture and a proof of that, so that it doesn't come as a surprise. It's actually, even if you so if you're just aware of the definitions of the Fisher information and the score function, is fairly self-evident, but I also don't want it to come as a surprise here. So as it's right now a little bit, so 1 over the square root of n times the score function of the sample corresponds to 1 over the square root of n times the sum of the score function of the individual random variables. What we've seen last week is that the expected value of the score function is 0, and that the variance of the score function is the expected Fisher information. So that was kind of one of the big proofs last week. This of course should be S theta here. And same here. So the fact that the variance of the score function corresponds to the expected Fisher information, which is quite crucial here, was proven last week. If you remember, there were these equality series that were going over full slide. And I have to speed up a little bit here. So the crucial thing here is the central limit theorem. So 1 over the square root of n times the sum of random variables, which are IID, converges in distribution to a normal distribution with expectation parameter given by n times mu and variance sigma square if these independent random variables have expectation mu, and then you sum them all up and you have variance sigma square. So the central limit theorem is crucial. I'm actually not 100% sure about this here. Let's put a little question mark there. If we apply the central limit theorem to these random variables that are the score function values at theta, then they converge in distribution to a Gaussian distribution with the same expectation, so zero. This is what we've shown last week, and variance corresponding to the expected Fisher information. So this is where we now have the normal or the asymptotic normality from. And finally, we need the fact that the Fisher information at theta converges in probability to the expected Fisher information. Here again we have the additivity property of the Fisher information, and we have the fact that the expected value of the Fisher information of a random variable obviously corresponds to j theta. This is just the definition of j theta. And here we can use the law, the weak law of large numbers. So the average of NID random variables converges with expectation mu, converges in probability to mu. And hence, if we just substitute that, we get already that 1 over n I n theta converges in probability to the expected Fisher information. Now we have all our building blocks, and now we can show this, where again, of course, here we need a theta ml minus theta. To show this, one actually uses first order Taylor approximation of the score function with expansion point corresponding to the true but unknown parameter value. So we have the score function at theta minus its derivative. Its derivative is of course the Fisher information, because the score function is the first derivative of the log likelihood function. Fisher information is the second derivative. The plus is turned into a minus here, times the first order deviation between tilde theta and theta, and substitute for tilde theta, we substitute the maximum likelihood estimator, and then here for tilde theta have the maximum likelihood, and here we have of course always the minus theta in there, as it should also be here. Of course, the at the location of the maximum likelihood estimator, the score function is zero, because that's where where maximum of the log likelihood function is. So then we can reformulate this here by multiplying by the square root of n, and then what's happening here? You're just dividing by in. And hence can write that square root times theta ml minus theta is Taylor approximated to first order by 1 over n the Fisher information to the power of minus n times this 1 over the square root of the score function. And these are the terms that we already considered. So we already considered these terms. So we've seen that this term corresponds in converges in distribution to the normal distribution. This converges in probability to the expected Fisher information. Now with Slutsky's theorem on the product here, based on this, and this, we can then infer that this thing converges in distribution to j theta minus 1 times n j theta. And then we are essentially there, although one thing that I'm missing here is the inverse. There's the square root. So this square root of theta and L converges in distribution to this. Well, there is something still open. This is of course the this is the longest and most involved proof of the entire lecture, and it's still a little bit under development as you start to realize. So the things are all there, but there are some typos still in there. So we need these four building blocks, and at one point there's still some kind of mistake in there, which I should remove. There are actually also two things that don't get quite clear yet from this proof, namely, first of all, that the distribution, that the convergence in probability holds also under forming the reciprocal. That might be quite trivial, but it should also be shown. And then what is then also not really completely clear is here how the fact that we are dealing with a Taylor approximation is then becomes irrelevant. So that is, from my current understanding of the proof, not quite clear. It might also be trivial, and I just don't know where it's coming from. But that can also be made more explicit. Yeah, good. But the key things in this proof, again, are the convergence in distribution of the score function to a normal distribution, and the convergence probability of the Fisher information to the expected Fisher information, then evaluated at the maximum likelihood estimator and under the use of the continuous mapping theorem and Slutsky's theorem, then showing that the maximum likelihood estimators asymptotically normally distributed with expectation parameter theta and variance j and theta. And as you realize, there are still some typos and some inconsistencies in this proof. Sorry for that, but it's only the second time that this lecture is happening, and it's also not the most trivial proof. Good, but what we will focus on, and I also need to stop here, what we will focus on is of course understanding what this actually wants to say, and for this we're going to look at some simulations. So let me sum up. We looked at different criteria in terms of the asymptotic behavior of estimators. We introduce asymptotic unbiasedness, consistency, asymptotic normal distribution, and asymptotic efficiency. And we have shown quite clearly that maximum likelihood estimators are not necessarily are not necessarily unbiased. And we've also seen quite clearly that they are consistent. And we have at least a good intuition why they are asymptotically normally distributed, based on things like the central limit theorem, the weak law of large numbers, Taylor approximation, score functions, Fisher information, and other interesting things. Okay, let's stop here. I also need to really to stop because the next lecture is starting, so we will postpone questions to the beginning of the exercise session. And in the exercise session we will first look at programming implementation of and frequentist sampling intuitions about asymptotic unbiasedness, and then have a look at what this asymptotic efficiency of a maximum likelihood estimator actually means for the Bernoulli and for for the Gaussian, and then I will show you some more proofs for consistency of basic statistics. Okay, then let's stop here and continue at 1 p.m. with the exercise session. Goodbye. Okay, then let's go for one last session on statistics for data science for today. And here we will be concerned with the theoretical exercises that accompany today's lecture, and these are essentially exercises regarding consistency. So in the programming part, we have studied asymptotic unbiasedness and mainly asymptotic efficiency now, and looked at what that means. And in these theoretical exercises, we look at consistency a little bit more, and the examples are the following. One is showing the consistency of the sample mean without using the mean squared error consistency criterion to make one's life a little bit more difficult than it is already. Show that the sample variance is a consistent estimator of the variance if its variance converges to zero, and show that the sample standard deviation is a consistent estimator of the standard deviation if the sample variance is consistent. And this is fairly low level, so it's just a little bit of doing math and doing some integration by substitution, but it kind of rehearses the notion of consistency. So let's have a look. For the first theoretical exercise, the aim is now to show consistency directly. So by considering the probability for the estimator to deviate from the true but unknown value, we consider the probability for the event that the estimate of interest deviates from the true but unknown value is this deviation is smaller than epsilon, and we look at the limit of these probabilities. So we want to look at this convergence in probability directly. So we instead of now considering the bias of the estimator and showing that this is zero and the variance that this approaches zero, for n going to infinity, we directly look at the probability for the event here that the absolute deviation between the estimator and its true but unknown value is smaller than some positive epsilon. And so we directly want to evaluate this, and we will evaluate this, and then in the end we will look at what happens if we have this probability, if we let n go to infinity. But first we want to actually write out the probability for this event here, and that's what's happening. So we first know already that the distribution of the sample mean is a normal distribution centered on the expected value of the random sample, and for a random sample with variance 1, the variance is 1 over n, and we actually considering the we could have also taken sigma square here, but we take the variance of 1. That's because this example in the Casella book is like that. Now we want to evaluate the probability, hence that this absolute deviation is smaller than epsilon, and hence we need to integrate the distribution of this estimator, the PDF of the distribution of this estimator over this interval. And this, of course, corresponds to the univariate Gaussian probability density with variance parameter 1 over n, so that we have this 1 over 2 pi to the power of 1/2, and this exponential term. And so we want to evaluate this integral here, and this can be done with integration by substitution. So I'm doing a bit of integration by substitution these days for whatever reasons, I have one way of writing this this way. I think if you have done a lot of integration by substitution, then you have a more automatized procedure to do that, but I'm fairly explicit. So integration by substitution being this theorem from basic calculus that the integral of a function evaluated at another function at x times the derivative of this function integrated from a to b is the same as evaluating the integral of the function fx only from the function g here applied to the integral boundaries. And to apply that to a specific integral, currently I'm always writing out the functions that play a role here, here the function gx would be the internal of the so this n half times x. So here I'm just replacing the x bar with x bar n with x. It's just the integration variable, and we have the derivative g of x, which is n half, and the function f then corresponding to 1 over 2 pi to the power of 1/2 and the exponential of minus 1/2 y square. So if you substitute this gx into this function and multiply by its derivative, you get back to this. So that's the whole construction here. So then we can re-express the integral that we are dealing with as follows. So that's the integral that we are dealing with, and now we first rewrite it in terms of f of gx g prime. This is what we then have here, and then we apply the transformation g, which is this transformation here, n 1/2 x minus mu. We apply this to the integral boundaries, where we here then already have just the PDF of the standard normal distribution. And this then corresponds to subtracting mu, so the mu goes away, and multiplying with square root 1/2. So then we get as the interval integral boundaries epsilon square root n and minus epsilon square root n, while we here still have the standard normal probability density function, and then have here I finally changed the integration variable. I think that's in integration by substitution, one normally changes the integration variable a little bit earlier and does this more automatized, but one doesn't need to change the integration variable. That's what I what's my issue with integration by substitution these days. That in any case we end up with talking about the probability of a standard normal random variable to fall within an interval from minus epsilon square root n to epsilon square root n. So we have reformulated this probability for the sample mean to for the absolute value of the sample mean minus the 2 but unknown value to be smaller than epsilon. We have reformulated this as the probability for a standard normal random variable to fall between square root of n times minus epsilon and epsilon times square root of n. And now, so this is just the reformulation, so this is not consistency yet, but now we it's fairly easy to look at the limit, because here it's not that trivial to look at the limit, but here it's trivial to look at the limit if we make the interval now larger and larger and larger, so we let n go to infinity. Then of course minus epsilon, epsilon is always positive, times the square root of n goes to minus infinity, and epsilon times the square root of n goes to plus infinity. So we're talking about the probability of a standard Gaussian random variable to take on a value somewhere on the real line, and this is of course 1 as n goes to infinity, because that it takes on any value is 1. You can also say that the PDF integrates 1, but that's clearly 1, so that it takes on any value between minus infinity and infinity. And because this event is the same event as the event of interest, then we have also shown that the probability for the absolute deviation between the sample mean and the true but unknown value to be smaller than epsilon goes to 1 as n goes to infinity, and this is exactly the definition of consistency. So this is kind of a direct way to show consistency of the sample mean, and it works by reformulating the event of interest in such a way that the dependency on the sample size is readily appreciated, because it is here just the probability for a standard normal random variable to take on any value in the real numbers. So that's how one can make one's life more difficult by not using the mean squared error consistency criterion, but then also going a little bit more into convergence in probability, because this of course is abolished if you just look at the square of the bias and the variance. Then you don't need to think about convergence in probability anymore. So that was theoretical exercise 1, which was already the I think the most complex of the three. The second one, to show the consistency of the sample variance. That's what's happening here. So here I formulated this in theorem form. So we assume that we have a random sample x1 to xn with PDF p theta. We call the expected value of of one of the random variables here of this random sample, we call that mu, we call the variance sigma square. We don't have a Gaussian, we just call the expectation and the variance that. And we define the sample variance as an estimator for the variance. And then the claim is that the sample variance is a consistent estimator of the variance if the variance of the sample variance goes to zero for n going to infinity. So one really needs to be precise with the language here, because there are definitely at least three variances. So there is the variance of these IID random variables, and that's called sigma square. There is the sample variance, which is an estimator, which estimates the true but unknown variance. And to show that this sample variance is actually consistent, we need to consider the variance of this estimator, which is of course not identical to this, because it's the variance of the estimator, not the variance of the random variables. Now, why does that hold? So the claim here is, if the sample variance goes to zero for n going to infinity, which of course depends on the distribution. So we've seen that. Have we seen that? So it of course, so the how the sample variance is distributed of course depends on the distribution. For the Gaussian, we will see that they are that it's chi-square distributed, but for different random samples of course these distributions might differ. But in any case, if the variance of the sample variance estimator goes to zero, then the sample variance is a consistent estimate of the variance. And how does this come about? Well, this is a direct consequence of Chebyshev's inequality. The probability, which I here just remind you, Chebyshev's inequality states that the probability for x, for the absolute value, I need a good term for that, a concise term for that. Chebyshev's inequality states that the probability for the absolute deviation of a random variable from its expected value to be larger than some small x is smaller or equal to the variance of the random variable divided by x squared. So we've seen this also in lecture 7. Yeah, so there's a upper bound on the deviation probability of a random variable from its expected value, and this upper bound is given by the variance of the random variable. Now, if we our random variable of interest is the sample variance, then the expected value of the sample variance is of course the true but unknown value, because the sample variance is unbiased. So we are actually concerned with the probability of the absolute deviation between the sample variance and the true but unknown variance to be larger or equal to some epsilon. And this is guaranteed to be always smaller than the variance of the sample variance divided by epsilon square. Now, if this upper term here, the numerator, goes to zero for n to going to infinity, then because it upper bounds this probability, then also this probability for a deviation larger than epsilon goes to zero, or reverse stated the other way around, the probability for the absolute deviation to be smaller than epsilon goes to 1, and hence the sample variance is a consistent estimator. So that's essentially just a criterion for the sample variance to be consistent. And of course it depends on the variance of the sample variance for a given parametric statistical model of interest. So which one then would have to look at and check whether this actually goes to zero for n going to infinity. If it does, then also the sample variance is a consistent estimator. And finally, the consistency of the sample standard deviation. So we again assume that we have a random sample, and we call mu, we call the expectation parameter of our IID random variables, we call that mu, the variance we call sigma square, and we again consider the sample variance. If the sample variance is a consistent estimator of sigma square, then the sample standard deviation, which we here also should subscribe with an n because we are looking at its asymptotic behavior, is a consistent estimator of the true but unknown standard deviation sigma. And this actually follows from something that we've also seen today, namely the continuous mapping theorem. So we first note that the continuous function theorem, or we called it differently, so let me briefly jump back there to this proof that still needs a little bit of work. The continuous mapping theorem, this thing here, this states that should, for consistency, call this, of course you know that it's the same, but so that a function and a mapping are the same thing, but for consistency we should call this mapping, that the continuous mapping theorem states that if a sequence of random variables converges in probability to a random variable x, and f is a continuous, and earlier we said a real valued univariate function, then also the functionally transformed random variables fx1, fx2 converge in probability to the functionally transformed random variable x, so fx. Now, because the square root is a continuous function, it thus follows that if the sample variance converges in probability to sigma square, so if the sample variance is consistent, then also this functionally transformed sequence here, so S2, S3, S4, converges to sigma. So This is then, if you study a specific example and you for some reason figured out that the sample variance is consistent, then you also know that the sample standard deviation is consistent, which is something. Good, so that was actually it. So we looked at the programming exercise already, and this also concludes our study of estimator properties. So in the last three sessions we've seen first the ideas of estimation, maximum likelihood estimation, and other ways to come up with estimators, and then we have now seen two lectures on evaluating estimators, in first the finite sample scenario, and today in the sample size going to infinity scenario. And now the next two lectures that remain in this kind of frequentist setting will be concerned with things that of course are often used in practice, namely confidence intervals, where we will use small sample size Gaussian theory, so t-distributions and chi-square distributions, but also large sample size approximations, like we've seen today, like normal approximations to the distribution of estimators. And once we've done that in confidence intervals, we will look at the kind of equivalent approach of doing hypothesis testing. And this will then also already conclude the frequentist statistics approach. So two more lectures on frequentist statistics, confidence intervals, and hypothesis testing. Good. From my side, that's it for today.